Greetings, saints of God. This is Dr. Terry A. Webb again with the Midday Inspiration. I'm coming to you once again from Christian Unity Baptist Church, where I am the pastor. I want to talk for a little while today about stress. Stress is something that seems to be surfacing in the media all the time. Because of this pandemic and the things that are going on in society, and this being the end of the year, and primarily the end of the year holidays are family holidays. We've had to endure the separation and mandatory relegation to a specified schedule by the governing bodies for Thanksgiving. And now, as reported, the situation is exponentially growing out of control as people are contracting COVID. So resultantly, people will be afflicted with stress, and stress is inevitable. However, what we must do as Christians is understand that stress is a part of life that can be managed through our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. See, stress is nothing but tension that can be emotional and physical. It is emotional and physiological response to a stimulus that's either internal or external of us, and it's difficulties that arise that cause us to experience stress, or unfamiliar situations that cause us to experience stress. All of us need to stop trying to predict everything that is going to happen and walk by faith and not by sight, because we really don't know what is going to happen. Because some elements of stress are germane to the human experience. You have life cycle stress, which is part of maturation and development into adulthood. We have adolescence, we have marriage, we have pregnancy, we have parenthood, we have people going through divorce. We deal with the trauma at some level of aging. The acceptance of not being able to do the things you could at 16, 17, 18 years old when you're 58, 59, 60 or older is unsettling to some, but it's part of normal growth and development. And as Christians, we need to make it a point to root ourselves in the Word of God and not be so fancifully connected to the practices of this world. We're to be in this world and not of this world. But there are also social stressors, such as unemployment because of COVID or otherwise, underemployment, where you know that your skill set and your capabilities far exceed those of the position that you're holding now to meet some of your financial obligations. You also know, too, of the urban problems that we face. In our society today, violence is being perpetrated at seemingly an alarming rate all the time whenever you turn the news on. People having changing values. There are people who are ambivalent in their values. Something could be wrong today and then be right the next, whereas Christians are to be immutable in their faith. If God's word says that it is wrong, then we are to adhere to the principle that God said in his word and not allow politics, social pressures, peer pressures, or whatever you want to deem them to be, something that causes you to let go of your God. No matter what is going on in society, we as Christians must remain carriers of the blood-stained banner of the Bible, taking it everywhere we go. Do we need to recite scripture everywhere? No. Our presence, our countenance, should be enough to let the world know that we're not like everybody else, because we're leaning and depending on God for all of our strength. Many of us now have lived long enough to know fully what it means to look up and see from where your help comes from. Saints of God, there are a lot of things that are going on in society that could cause us to stress out if we don't look up and get down on our knees and pray to God for guidance and direction. He did not say that all of this would go without any hiccups, and we would never fall down. But through the grace and power of God, we can get back up. The anxiety that many of us are experiencing is proportional to a lack of creativity in how we're viewing life. If we focus on what we've lost, then we can't see the potential new gains that are arriving in our lives as a result of the lifestyle change that has occurred all of a sudden due to this pandemic. When we stop focusing on what we perceive to have lost, when we should look at it from the perspective of it being on layaway, that is, that we will eventually be able to hug and commune with our friends again in large crowds once again. Rest assured, saints, that it will happen once again on this side. If not, we know that when we get to glory, we're all going to see each other. That's why we need to limit some of the personal stress that we're placing upon ourselves, trying to do everything the way we want to do it. It is absolutely amazing to me how people are planning big Christmas dinners with elderly people and people in their community that you know are sick. And by now, most people know of, if not related to, or have direct connection to someone who has been afflicted by COVID. Even myself, my own sister that is closest to me in age, she's not in this state, has been afflicted with it. And as a result of it, she's starting to complain about some things and residual effects. So there's personal things that stress impacts us. It's our feelings, our expectations. Our expectation is to do what we need to do to ensure an increased likelihood of success while we're on this earth for the time that God has given us. Our expectations sometimes must never be put down, but we need to be realistic in our expectations. Nothing is ever going to be perfect on this side. Nothing will always go the way that we want it to go. People act as if they don't have one meal for our end of the year, that their life will be over with these people. If your love for individuals cannot exceed past one day, waiting for something to break so that you can stay together. I kind of look at it like this, and being a pastor, when we used to be able to do hospital visits, we would always have members who were in a hurry to get home. And then sometime they would just let them go home and they end up right back in there longer than if they had stayed and fully recovered just because they wanted to get out. Sometime we need to stay in and sit down so that we can regroup and we can commune with God. If your family dismisses you or don't come around you for one day, are you really going to perish? Are you really going to lose the reason for the season this year anyway? Jesus is the reason for the Christmas season. If I call you and talk to you, I love you no more or no less than I would if I was in front of you, eating up your food and enjoying your free heat. I know this, our expectations must be rooted and grounded in the Word of God. Because a lot of us are dealing at this time with dissatisfaction with our lives. We have a lot of people who look, smell, act, and do the things that adults do, but they're actually an adolescent trapped in an adult body because they're so dissatisfied with everything around them. They feel as if they have to be doing something all the time, when in reality, sometimes we got to slow down so that we can move forward. In this time of year, it is starting to be cold outside. Unlike many of you, I'm really not fond of cold weather. But this is a time, instead of running the streets, going out spending money that you shouldn't, or being out in an environment that could be potentially hazardous to your life, causing potential death for someone, somewhere, somehow, on the premise that you are going to have fun because it's loud and noisy and it's crowded. Now may be a time for you to spend time with God, to go into your prayer room and see where God wants to direct and lead and guide your life. And we have to learn how to deal with conflict. We have to, because living in the house with somebody all the time, conflict is inevitable. So in essence, we need to lean and depend on God. We need to stop thinking so much about ourselves. Does it not say in Matthew that the second commandment, after love thy Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy mind and thy soul, that the second one is to love your neighbor as yourself? See, while we're confined in our homes, wouldn't it be beneficial to us to learn how to love ourselves? A lot of people say they love themselves, but they don't. You can tell by the way they dress. You can tell by the way they speak. You can tell by the way they act that there is something going on in that situation with themselves that they're not necessarily in love or give themselves the proper respect that they do so deserve. The monotony and the boredom is evident. We may have to turn back to some of the old school things we used to do. Pull out an old school Monopoly board. Don't play the digital version. Pull out the old school Trouble game. Play Spades. Play, what's this thing? Uno. They even have a new version of it. Play some of the board games, Trivial Pursuit, and this one Gestures, or the one where you draw the pictures, a line on the board, and somebody pulls out that it's a Major League Stadium. Those are things that we can do to build community. Those are things that we can do to hold together with the people that we're in immediate contact with in our homes. And we need to make it a point to not allow ourselves to be relegated to happenstance. We need to stay on the schedule. We need to be proactive in planning our time such that we don't spend too much time on anything, because there are people who are really bored very easily. But with those individuals, if you look at it for a second, there is no way that God is boring, because God is an awesome God who reigns from the heavens above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. And saints, we need to be careful to not allow public opinion to denigrate the integrity of our relationship to God. So many people really believe that because the pandemic is going on, so many people believe because they lost their job, so many people believe that because they're struggling with some form of indigence, that God is not real, that God has forgotten about them. Actually, it's just like Peter when he's walking on water. If you are in the midst of a storm, it is generally when God is closest to you. The issue is we have to stop focusing on the storm and start to look past the storm and see the calm that is coming after the storm. And you see Jesus with his hand stretched out saying, "Come unto me," saying, "My yoke is easy and my burdens are light." When we focus so much on the things we don't like, when we focus so much on the things we cannot control, we have a tendency to allow public opinion, public attitudes, and our own biases negate the impact of our faith. See, we shouldn't be worried about material things. Jesus spoke about these things in Matthew 6:25. He said, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about what you will eat, drink, or what you will wear. After all, isn't life more important than food, and isn't your body more important than clothing?" That doesn't mean that we should not be proactively seeking to work, especially men. But God created you as a special, unique person. God gave you life and a body. He is not going to forget about you. Jesus then goes on to describe how God makes sure the birds have enough food. And you are much more valuable than they are, because we're all made in the image of God. Do you realize the Hebrews were in the wilderness and God provided for all their needs? One of the issues that we have is that we feel we must have a certain status level in order to feel that God loves us. See, in essence, saints, beloved, we must realize that we cannot worry about the things that we have no control over. That's why Jesus says in Matthew 6:27, "Who of you by worrying can add one single hour to your life?" Too many of us spend so much time in our lives stuck in nowhere, in despair, in a quagmire, sinking to the point that our heads are underwater because we're so focused trying to control things that we were never intended to control, that we would never have the ability to control. See, we have to understand, we can't get stuck in our past. So many people get stuck in their past because they want their life to be a specific way, when in reality, that's not how God works. So many of us are stuck in our past, trying to make something out of something that was never supposed to exist. Yes, you might have messed up. Yes, you might have been incarcerated. Yes, you might have been foolish in your decisions. But where you've been doesn't necessarily define where you go. Now, where you have been, the things you have been to, should give you the power and the wisdom that you need through life experiences. When you inextricably connect that to the word of God, that you're now elevated to a new sense of awareness, that you now understand that as low as you have been, you got back up, not by your own power, not by your own might, but by the power of God interceding in your life and flowing through you through the Holy Spirit. That's why you were able to survive the things that you've been through. That's why it is absolutely an aberrant fact that we should be worried about tomorrow. Jesus says in Matthew 6:34, "Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." We should live, saints beloved, one day at a time. We can plan for tomorrow and work and get ready for tomorrow, but don't worry about tomorrow. So many of us wake up in the morning worried about what's going to happen at work, how it's going to go in getting to work. What are they going to say? What are they going to do? We do not need to spend the precious time that God has allotted us on this earth worried about things that we cannot control, things that we have nothing to have any affect on. And some things are just inevitable. Rabbits hop, dogs bark, cats meow, gorillas beat their chests, giraffes are tall. And guess what? bears growl. Those are inevitable facts. People eat, they get sick, they fall down, they get up, they heal, they reproduce, they get married, they raise children, they go to work, they lose jobs, they lose homes, they get new homes, they get new jobs, they get lose friends, they get new friends, people pass away, they meet other people, there's people that passed away, living them through the love that you shared with them when they were alive, so that they live forever in your personhood. The thing about it is, there are things that are just inevitable in this world that we need to stop focusing on. Yes, we have no impact on who becomes the president. Yes, we have no knowledge of what the president really does. We have an idea. We don't really know what they're talking about when they sit at these tables. We don't know anything, but we do know that through the power of God and our faith and our commitment, knowing that our God got up on the third day with all power in his hand to give us hope above all hope, because he will do whatever he needs to do to take care of his children, just like many of us will work three jobs to provide for the needs of our children. If not, shame on you. But our Heavenly Father is not like all of us. His word is his bond. His word is who he is. You can lean and depend on the word of God. You can actually stand on the word of God. His promises are true. God will not lie to anybody. If you're his servant and you commit to him and you're obedient and you love him with all your heart and all your mind and your soul, God will make a way somehow. Yes, and God will take care of you. I know he will do it. I'm a living testimony that God can take the lowest of us and make us, some of us, the best. God will work with you through all of your anxiety and your stress, and you will learn to love even when it's not even popular. You will learn to love even when it's not even easy, when it's very difficult. You will learn to do what God has called you to do. And when you love above all else, knowing that love heals a multitude of sins, you will be able then to go out into this sin-sick world and not hold your head down worrying about what's going to happen, because you know who holds tomorrow. You know who's in control of today, and you know that your destiny is sure in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So saints of God, don't ever at any given time allow your worry to be your trouble. Don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow has its own worries of itself. Let's get through this. Don't be anxious about anything, but take everything to God in prayer, petitioning with thanksgiving. If you don't have what you think you need, you have something that God gave you, so be thankful. Present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Jesus Christ. Trust in the Lord and do good. Delight yourself in the Lord. Commit your way to the Lord and be still before the Lord and wait patiently on him. Never give up, never give out, never give in. An anxious heart weighs a person down, but a kind word can cheer them up. A heart at peace gives life to the body. But understand this, a cheerful heart is good medicine, saints of God. Never give up, never give out. It may be dark, but know that in the midst of all darkness, light is coming, and all it takes is a little bit of light for to get our attention and to get us focusing in the right direction. Don't let anxiety and stress steal your joy, because this joy I have, the world didn't give it to me. This joy I have, God gave it to me. So saints of God, this is Pastor Reverend Dr. Terry A. Webb of Christian Unity Baptist Church, leaving you with the midday inspiration. Never give up on God. Never let go of God. No matter what you're facing, know that God is with you. He will never put more on you than you can handle, and he's always standing there, just like that footprint poem. When you thought you couldn't, God did it. God carried you when you could not carry yourself. Many of us know that we grew up poor and we always ate. We always had something to wear. It wasn't necessarily what we wanted, but we had what we need. And God blessed us to be in situations, to be thankful for allowing us to make it to where we are today. We got here not by an education, not by our pedigrees, not by ingenuity, but we are where we are today because of the grace of God oozing all through us. Our faith in God will help us make it through all anxiety, all stress, and our faith will give us the capacity to love, exhibit charity, so that we can defeat that demon of fear that is holding many of us hostage because we're so focused on what we cannot do that we can't see the work that God is doing in our lives. Take care, God bless, and go somewhere and study and pray about the word of God such that you can hear a word from the Lord. God loves you, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Amen. Amen.